you're trying to.
Please, I'm talking about, to this point, we have not had that type of request.
I don't think we've had anything proposed that have come through the pipeline with that.
So you're just wanting to put that in the book in case it comes up?
It's already in the land use plan.
Of the current name?
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing I will tell you is that, and this is where it starts getting a little tricky, is communities that are keeping it at very low densities, at up to 2 dwelling units a year across the board, you're doing what's called sprawl, and that you're taking the, we'll say, the exact same number of units on, we'll say, a 10-acre piece of property that in this case would support 100 units, and now you spread it out over the course of a lot greater area, which means that you are paying more for utility and infrastructure to get out to that point. You're having to pay more for your public services to serve that area instead of it being more compact, condensed. Now they're having to run further links as far as police, fire, and all of that. So you're also using the land very inefficiently at that point. Now, the one thing I will say is we're not saying that this needs to be everywhere in the city, by no means. But as communities continue to grow, you want to make sure that you're growing in an efficient manner, not only from a compatibility standpoint, but also from a services standpoint, cost of being cost efficient.
Well, when I think of it, that's something would be like in Charlotte, like a light rail line. Like
they're a lot higher than that.
Well, I know that.
but yes.
You said downtown, you know, if it was a higher rise, you know, I just didn't know.
You know, one of the things that you could start seeing, and not say this is the exact district that you want to do it, but let's say that you had some sort of transit, bus rapid transit, or something, a connector between here and downtown Charlotte, you would most definitely want to have something that has a higher density and even a non-residential component around those transit stops. Why? Because those are the folks that typically, you know, you won't be close to transit, so you don't have to worry about the cars, and you can walk to it at that point.
The only thing that worries me, and I'm not trying to take up time, is people on the planning board and the city, we get inundated right now with all these subdivision proposals where they're shoehorning 1,200 units in 2 acres, and they're going to see this, and they're going, oh man, they got this high density, so we can put this in there. You know what I'm saying?
Well, there again, looking at your adopted land use plan, that's where the staff and, you know, planning board and the council need to be looking at, because if it shows up as low density, you really should have a very good justification on why you're not staying with that density. Just because it's in there doesn't mean it's an automatic approval or grant.
Right.
Good question, though. So let's talk about the business districts. I'm going to move a little bit quicker through this, just because what we're trying to do there again is create a new standard for, in this case, office and medical.
Billion. I apologize, but before we leave that, you might think it might be the proper time to talk about the planning board and the council in terms of growth density. We've already made a decision. Consider that, and most every community is of our size or surrounded by a metropolitan area like Charlotte is forcing out. So, though we may not have any people asking for that higher density residential at this time, but that doesn't mean, as you said, from an efficiency of scale and we're probably going to be forced to look at some of those kinds of things. And why wouldn't we even want to consider those? You know, if you're going to want to be R40 for the rest of your life, then you're limiting your growth, which is going to limit a lot of other things. And if you want to be a progressive city, you're going to have to go with some philosophy of higher density. Is that not correct, or is that not what you find most communities going?
I will tell you that I do a lot of work around the Southeast, and the one thing that you can either think about is you can embrace the growth and plan for it, or you can bury your head in the sand and it goes to the next community over, which means they drive through your community, so they're using your resources and you're not getting the benefit from that at that point.
Well, I
get this, my thoughts.
through our community, or they will stop.
They're always going to continue to direct you, you know, point A to point B, what's the best way to do it? Now, it's just where do they live, where do they shop, where do they do, you know, their daily, whatever. So if you've got the opportunity here, then you can create that as an opportunity. You're creating a choice. Otherwise, you're not allowing any choices. You're automatically saying, now go to the next community. What's up there? And there is, and I would say, we're the time right now where there is growth. You're all are not the only ones facing a growth challenge in and around this area and around this country. I will tell you that there's a lot of places that have done a giant import, and I do not mean McDonald's. And they've kind of taken the stance of, we don't want any more at any cost. And that sets up a whole different set of challenges. But it also starts, what we're seeing is the revenues aren't coming in to support the services, because the cost of services are still going up. They don't have the revenues in turn to come back and address that. So in turn, schools, police, fire, water, wastewater, all those things are starting to go, actually start to degrade a little bit. They don't have the income stream. And I'm not saying you all are in that position by any means. I'm just saying some of the communities we talked to and worked with.
Doesn't our growth need to be a variety with optional choices rather than the same wall-to-wall homes that look exactly like every other development that's being proposed?
So one of the challenges is that the state law says you can only do certain things within certain areas. So if it's a traditional residential district, you've got this much room to play in the sandbox. If you do a conditional district or a different district, then you've got this much more to work in. Now, the one thing that you cannot do is to sit there and go, okay, Ryan Homes or one of the other large home builders is like, well, we don't like you, but we like you. You can't go to that level. You can start looking at some, I'll say, creative design options under certain circumstances, and that's one of the things we're talking with staff about, how do you look at that. And that's where some of the incentives come into play that we're talking. So when we talk about choices, we set this up as, here's your baseline that you can do in certain areas. Great. You've got the choice to do that, or if you want to make the choice, the conscious choice, and go, I'm going to come right here on this piece of property, and I'm going to propose or ask this, and I'm willing to go with differences in lot sizes, with building heights, with open spaces, with buffers, or things like that. Then there's some development incentives or offsets that the city can provide. So you can start kind of, I'm not going to say negotiating, but you in essence are reaching some sort of agreement that, yeah, we're willing to do this if we do this. But there again, the options are there in about four different ways to do something completely different.
And then they'll very quickly tell us they can't make the numbers
work. We hear it all the time.
Economics? We should be thinking about the economics. But.
Okay. Your question answered.
Okay.
So the commercial, started to introduce that, but primarily office, medical, some potential residential, but trying to use that a little bit more as a buffer between, say, your commercial, but also some of your straight-up single family. So you start seeing some of these step-downs or some transitional uses where it makes sense. So the one district you have right now, we're actually talking about expanding and modifying that a little bit. This is the new one that we're talking about adding, which is a commercial neighborhood. So a small scale commercial that would be on a much smaller scale. It would not be your typical commercial corridor or what you see along 74 or some of the other major intersections. We're talking about, you know, buildings that are a couple thousand square feet, limited types of uses. It may be right there at the intersection, but it's not going beyond the intersection by more than a lot depth. So you start saying, you know, what are those neighborhood types of uses, neighborhood-serving uses that can really benefit that area? So this is one of the ones that we're kind of creating, as far as to say, there's a difference between commercial and neighborhood commercial. And again, part of that also came out of the land use plan itself. Then there's the general commercial. That's what you have right now. That's your typical commercial. That's your restaurants, your drive-ins, your laundromats, your retail. A lot of the stuff that you see, that is still covered under this. Now, the city does have design standards in play right now. But what we have identified working with staff is, you've got some, but you don't have the full range that you can do. So one of the things we're going to talk about towards the end of this is, what are we recommending that the city consider as part of this? Now, we're not saying that this is going to be so onerous that the development community is going to come in and go, no one else in this region is doing this. To the contrary, most of the communities across the region are doing something. Some more, some less. It becomes a personal preference for what does the city want to do. Very simple.
Kenny, go back a minute.
Yes,
that, the commercial neighborhood, is that like, can it include assisted living, group homes, stuff like that?
We actually have some of the uses called out in the use table. And we'll go through that in just a moment.
Okay.
If I don't answer that question specifically, ask me.
Okay.
Thank you. Industrial. This is one of the ones that in talking with staff, they said, you know, we need some level to, there again, kind of like neighborhood commercial and general commercial, we need some level to be able to break out, I'll say low intensity or light industrial from your general industrial, because there's certain types of industrial that can coexist with a lot of different things. Believe it or not, some of your high-tech industries are defined as industrial. Some of those employment-generating types of uses are defined as industrial. At the same time, and I'm not trying to scare you, but you know, the tanneries, the car crushing, all of that, without certain standards, can be side by side. So what we did was said, okay, let's break apart and create a light industrial and your general industrial. Not taking away uses, but saying here's an option. And at the same time, also coming up with some level of design standards, very limited, but some design standards on the appearance and the of the buildings and structures themselves. That's the heavy. So then we get into planning districts, and this is kind of that hybrid where we're not saying it's the conditional district at this point, but there are some potentials for maybe planned commerce, where you've got a true mix of uses, commercial, retail, restaurant, but also with that residential feel. You're going to see, probably say, but Kelly, that's going to sound a lot like what you're talking about with the mixed use districts. But the mixed-use districts were actually called out specifically per your land use plan. This wasn't. These are areas that could be along 74 that aren't falling in within mixed-use districts now. There again, that's another option to start thinking about. Increased standards, but the trade-offs are there for a true mix of uses. Things that you're seeing like in Valentine and Matthews and other places in and around Metro Charlotte, looking at something like that as the model. Now, are these percentages as far as 25% open space or 10% multifamily, are those the right numbers of the thou shalt? Here's how the formula works. No. We start with that. We start looking at how does that model actually work, and then we start refining as we're moving forward. So one of the things we've already been talking about with staff is we know we need to go back and kind of play with these numbers a little bit, but let's start the discussion now. And then kind of the flip-flop of that, this one is more residentially based, less commercial. The last one was more commercial, less residential, but a similar type of approach. Now, there again, conditional districts are still out there. That is a tool that is available under 160, as well as your current code. So we know we've got provisions for those. We're just trying to provide some additional options in other areas as well. Now, that's not to say that somebody couldn't come in and say, well, I'd like what you're doing in that planned commerce, but I'd rather do it as a conditional district commercial and do the same thing. That's where city staff and everybody can kind of come together and go, okay, we'll do it this way, but here's kind of what we're thinking. And we start that discussion process. There again, it's additional flexibility. Now, at the end of the day, you may go, too complex, we don't even want to deal with that, we just want to go to traditional districts and mixed use and that.
Great.
You're not going to hurt our feelings. But we want to give you enough tools to be able to say, we thought about it, we considered it, we're not there, we'll just go with this. Absolutely, we can make that work. So you keep hearing me talk about mixed use districts. Your land use plan actually starts talking about these areas that actually show up in your land use plan. This is actually a screenshot from your land use plan. And it starts identifying the downtown, Concord Avenue, traditional development community corridor, the medical district, and other things throughout the city. So in keeping with that, one of the things that the plan was talking about was form-based code. Now, we've talked about form-based code a couple of times, and that can be a three-letter word, can actually be a four-letter word to some communities. So instead of saying, thou shalt do a form-based code, we say we're going to use form-based code principles. So urban design and higher design standards to go with it. And I'm going to say this is, we did this to staff, and staff passed, your staff passed this test. Because we've been working with communities, and they say, oh, just got back from a conference, and I heard a great session on form-based code. First thing I do is usually go, okay, what's your definition of a form-based code? Well, I'm not sure. Well, what do you want to try to do with it? Well, they said, and you start asking the questions, and then it's really, they don't have a good comprehension of it. You go to other communities, and as soon as you say form-based code, they start thinking of certain communities that they've been to and go, we don't want to try to deal with that amount of regulation.